gospel is never fully ours until we share it, until we begin to proclaim the good news. The Bible says to go, therefore, into all the nations, teaching them, making disciples, baptizing in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We're going to do things a little bit differently today. Instead of jumping right back into our 1 Peter series, I just want to talk with you today. I want to visit with you a little bit, encourage you a little bit. But in light of our testimony, in light of this post-Easter experience, I'm going to be asking you the question throughout the rest of our time today, is this: what difference does Easter make to you? What difference has Easter made in your life? The fact, not just an Easter Sunday, not just another day of the week, and not just a one big Sunday that we have out of the year, but what is there different in your life because of the resurrection that wasn't the same before? We've seen the same power that brought Jesus from the grave, the same power that lives in us, the power of your love is changing you. Really, what's changing you? I'm going to ask Michelle to come forward today. Part of this going and sharing the gospel means everywhere you go. This means that we're going to teach our kids in our home. We're going to go to work. We're going to share the gospel at work with our lives and with our words. In our neighborhoods, we had somebody in the first service today bring their next door neighbor, and they came for the first time. Maybe that's you. Maybe you've got some neighbors here today. Wherever you go, we're sharing the gospel. But God brought Michelle Maroon to us a few years ago, and she had a passion for prison ministry. And I've asked him to come today and share, before we get started into the message, a little bit about what she's experienced, where she's been able to get involved with, and how we can also, as a church, be involved in it. So, Michelle, come on up.
You want to hold it, you want to raise it up. All right, here you go.
Hello, Second Service, my homie crowd. This is to keep me on task at 1 minute. Kairos, it's a strange word. It's a Greek word, and it stands for God's special time, or also the fullness of time. Kairos is a prison ministry that is aimed at developing a Christian community inside of a prison. Amy Simpson and I are here today on behalf of a newly formed Kairos chapter that's going into the Tennessee Prison for Women in Nashville. We're going on our second weekend inside at the end of the month. Volunteers on a Kairos team, they show the love and forgiveness of Jesus Christ. It's a 3.5-day weekend, and we basically have talks and meditations, chapel visits, lots of music, lots of love, lots of listening. If anyone has participated in a Tres Dias weekend or a Walk to Emmaus weekend, this is a very similar program to that. It's just modified a little bit for the inside. After participating in a Kairos weekend, the Kairos team goes back once a month. A couple of volunteers go back once a month to facilitate prayer and share discussions with the ladies. These are accountability groups. And basically, it helps them in their newfound faith and in their walk with the Lord. Because believe me, folks, it's very difficult to be a new Christian, a growing Christian, inside of such a dark place. At this point, I want to cut to a videotape. This is a gentleman who went through the Kairos program in a men's prison.
I'm going to tell you about Kairos, this prison ministry that comes inside them walls to dead men. A lot of people say me dead men. And I was just a mad man. Everybody got a story. When you really get touched by God, that's when we know you got a real story. Well, my name is Tommy Fisher. I was born and raised in Los Angeles, California. I grew up in the street gangs there. I got a lot of trouble. I ended up doing 20 years, 11 months flat in prison. I had an aggravated life sentence. I wasn't supposed to never get out. I ran the gangs in prison. You know, and I hurt a lot of men for some crazy reasons. I used to actually get Christians beat up because they say they wanted to come to Christ. That's how crazy and radical I was. But when they pick Kairos, they only pick the worst inmates on the unit because they want the roughest dudes on the unit, the fools, to get changed. And this ministry is actually going in here and showing this love and changing people like that. I'm going to tell you the truth. I went for their food. I didn't go to get saved, but God had set me up. When I was sitting there, man, when I was listening to this dude talk, you know, when Paul was on the road to Damascus, and Jesus' presence shot him off that horse, I know for a fact, I felt the presence of the Holy Spirit. I felt like Paul felt. And from that day forth, man, God has just been blessing my life. While I was in that prison, I got into this Third Pond Theological Seminary and Bible Institute. I got a bachelor's degree in biblical studies. I also went to college and I got me an LDT. I just thank God for God's blessing. I got a license to counsel. You know, and I really thank God for what He changed me into, because I used to be a monster. I used to really be a monster. The only reason why I don't know if I ever killed a man, because I never went back and asked the man who I shot was he dead. But I shot a lot of people, and I hurt a lot of people's lives. But ministries like Kairos can go inside the walls and show a man God's love. Man, if I could tell anybody about Kairos, man, it's changing lives. Because I got to get God back what He gave me. He gave me back my life. He gave me the years that the locust stole from me. He gave them back to me. And I'm thankful for it.
Michelle came in October and talked about it last year, and I heard about this ministry. I was so excited. I said, I have to be part of this ministry. So I have been in the trainings these past few weeks, getting prepared to go into the prison for the women, and I'm excited and I'm pumped, and I can't wait to go in there into the prison and teach these ladies about Jesus and about forgiveness and just love on these ladies. So, in your bulletin today, you probably noticed things falling out at you, right? So, the first thing that you'll notice is that little slip. Everybody has a different color. And what this is a prayer strip. So what you can do is fill it out. And what we're gonna do with it is, and here's the example. The children over there in the children's side have already filled out some of them. And it is going to be wrapped around the building that we're in. And this is gonna let the ladies know how much we love them and that we're praying for them. So this is going to be a very emotional part for them, because a lot of them think that we don't love them, that nobody prays for them. This is going to show them that they're loved. The other thing that you have in your bulletin was a little card. And this card, you can fill out, put your first name only, please, and then your city. And this is a donation card for their meals. So we're asking that you do $5. And this is to provide meals for them. For the weekend, we do home-cooked meals for them. So somebody comes in and cooks for them. These ladies don't get home-cooked meals. Some of these ladies are in there for life. So they haven't had a home-cooked meal in a long time. So they're gonna get home-cooked meals, and so that costs a little bit. So we're asking that if you can donate $5 to help provide a meal, that'd be great. And you're going to actually, your name will be put in front of them. So the card, every meal, your ticket goes in front of them, and then, bring a place card, but the kids over there made place cards for them, and they decorated them with different sayings and cute things. One of them said, Jesus loves you and I love you, and they put a little picture of a Bible up there and said hi, and just things like that to let them know they're loved and that they're cared about, and they're going to have that for them as well. And then, if you don't mind sticking that inside of the offering envelopes, and you can just fill that out. And we have little baskets out there. You can put your prayer strips in there and your donation cards, and then we can gather those up. The other thing we need is cookies. So there is about 650 residents inside of the prison, and there's about 250 workers. We pass out cookies to all of them, homemade cookies to all of them, as an act of love and showing that we care about them. And so we need your help. So if you're interested in baking cookies, myself or Michelle, and we can talk to you about kind of how to do that and what all is involved in that. And then just, of course, prayer. Overall, we need prayer for the whole weekend, and just that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. We talk about that. And we'll start off with that today. I mean, we're not going to highlight all the ministries that we do here at Faith Church, but this is the one that's new to us. And Michelle's been here for a few years, but she began to share more about it and what it means and what she's been experiencing there, getting Amy involved in that now. It's open for anybody that'd like to participate. Many people come to me all the time and say, man, how can I help? How can I serve? How can we be a part of things? There's lots of things to do, and we'll talk about those as we go forward today, but this is one area of ministry that is crucial to who we are as believers in Christ. When God's at the end of days separates the sheep and the goats, there's going to be the righteous on one side and the unrighteous on the other side. How is it going to know which ones? The ones who did it the least of these, my brothers, he said, you've done it to me. When you were hungry, when I was hungry, you gave me something to eat. When I was thirsty, you gave me something to drink. When I was sick, you visited me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was in prison, you came and visited me. And the disciples were like, Lord, when did we do that? He said, when you did it for these brothers of mine, you did it to me. And so as we get into this ministry and as we talk about more about this today and in the upcoming weeks, it is merely a response to this question: what difference has Easter made in you? Because if Easter is making a difference in you, if the resurrection and the new life is truly in you, then all of a sudden you're going to be looking for ways to be that for others, to share that gospel, to be the gospel, to be the good news. Because the world is messed up, y'all. I'm telling you that. You come from it. You live in it. You work in it. You have to correct kids that come home with it. You know? There's a dying, there's a lostness, there's a hopelessness and a helplessness that you're surrounded with. What do you give them? What do you know to give them? And so we'll be talking to you a little bit about that today. But first, I want to brag on you a little bit and tell you how proud I am of you. Last week was a really cool Sunday. And everybody spruces up for Easter. You know, I get that. Everybody has a big crowd on Easter. We spruce up the place and make sure that it's extra nice or extra clean. We clean up stuff in the back alley. We clean up stuff on the front porch. We go the extra mile just to make that special day even more special. But what's the difference between Monday and Sunday when it comes down to it? Yeah. Sun goes to bed on Easter Sunday night and wakes up the next day and you're right back at it again. And you come in, you get you get all filled up, and you got your big pep rally going on, and then you're right back into it again. And if really, if there's no difference in you from the pep rally to the game day, what's the point? What's really the point, right? This is the point. It's living the vision, it's living the hope, it's living the gospel. I was telling a friend of mine, we were visiting with this some time ago, and I said, it's like, you know, because he played football in high school, and I said, you know, what would be the outcome if you get the whole school together, and a lot of you in there in school, you know what these are all about. You have these pep rallies, right? And you get together, man, you're all fired up, and the band's playing, and the cheerleaders are cheering, and they introduce all the football players, and man, everybody's just all excited. It's a big day. It's a really special big day because you get out of class early so you can go to pep rally. Man, I remember these things. Man, they were really, really cool. But what if you went straight from the pep rally and right into the game? Okay? What's the difference in the football team, right? Well, they're emotionally on a high, right? But what if for all week long they haven't practiced, they didn't watch film, the coaches didn't show up, so nobody was coached, there was no game plan, no plan of action or anything like that. They go straight out of the pep rally right into the game. How successful are they going to be? They're going to fail miserably, aren't they? They're going to fall flat on their face. They're going to get steamrolled by the other team, no matter how bad they do. Because you've got a whole group of people, a whole big group of people on a football team, and now all of a sudden they have to start figuring out what everybody does. And if you don't practice, and if you're not taught the game, all you have is a good feeling about yourself because you just came to the pep rally and everybody was cheering your name and wearing your jersey and patting you on the back and saying how proud they are of you. And man, you're doing great. Now go out there and do it. All you got is a pep rally. you're going to lose. You're going to fail miserably in this world because it's rough, and you're going to get steamrolled. Doesn't matter how weak the enemy may be, you're going to get steamrolled if you're not prepared. And so let me tell you what I saw last week. When I saw people coming in, I saw a lot of new faces, a lot of new people coming in. And you know what? It's real easy to get involved in your own little circle of influence. You know what I'm talking about? You all sit in the same section every week. Some of you are kin to each other, so you kind of come in and sit in the same spot. But man, I saw a lot of people talking to new faces last week. I saw a lot of people engaging with people that they normally don't. I saw a lot of laughter. Everybody can say that they're a friendly church. And depending upon where you sit, we may be a friendly church. You may sit in another spot where nobody talks to you because you're an introvert. The person next to you is an introvert. And it doesn't matter what's going on in the room. You're not going to talk to each other. You're scared to death thinking, man, I'm going to make a mistake. I'm going to welcome somebody that's brand new. They're going to say, I've been a member here for 100 years. What's your problem? You know, it's not about that. You know, you're scared to meet each other. You're scared to have a conversation with somebody because you think you're supposed to have something, you know, a secret knowledge or a secret handshake or a fist bump or something like that that you're supposed to know. And it's not about anything like that. But I saw people engaging and I saw people welcome each other. I saw a lot of people laughing. And you know what? That proves to me and shows me that the body is healthy to see you laughing together. We may or may not be a friend of the church, depending upon where you sit. But I hear a lot of laughter in the church. I see a lot of joy in the church. And you know what? Sometimes it's coming from people that are really, really hurt, really messed up. But when you come here, there's an engagement here that you can kind of leave some of that behind you a little bit and get involved with somebody here. And I'm so proud of you. Let me tell you how easy that makes my job. I got the best job in the world. When I get to come and I get to open the Word with you and share the gospel with you, but I get to see you, I get to experience you, I get to, you feed me and I get to feed you and I encourage you and you encourage me. I don't know what happened this week. It was really, really interesting. Angela and I got to have the joy and the privilege of meeting with our tax attorney in Nashville this week, and what an exciting time that was. And, you know, as we were dealing with all of that, and I told somebody, our whole structure of things has changed in the last, you know, year or two, and things have been going on really strange, but man, you know what, we go, we meet with that cat down there for an hour. We come up, we've been thinking about, you know, what are we going to do and how are we going to make this, you know, we're going to really have to cut back, we're going to have to save, we're going to have to do some things and to meet this requirement that Uncle Sam is demanding of us. And at 4 o'clock that afternoon, here comes the postman, and he drops off the mail in there. We've been playing basketball in the driveway. And even Angela played horse with us, you know. And so we were just playing some ball, and here comes the postman, and we go out there, we get it, and it's just a blank kind of envelope addressed to me, and I open it up, and there's an anonymous check in there that just fits the bill. And right there in front of God, the neighborhood, and the basketball court, and everything, we wanted to have a little spell. It's just knowing, who are you to fret? Who are you to worry about anything? Is that too much for me? And you know what? I don't know if it was any of you people. I don't know if it was anybody that somebody else that we've talked to. It could have been our tax guy having mercy on us for something. Who knows? But it wasn't any government address. I can guarantee you that. Not a lot of mercy there. But it was just such a beautiful, sweet thing. It's just saying, God's faithful. And so if that was you, thank you. I don't know who you are. And I don't care to know who you are. But thank you so much. If God used you to provide for us. I see that all the time. And I see it coming from you. There's some big hearts out here, and I can't brag on you enough of how grateful I am to be a part of this ministry and to join with you. There's no sermon notes today because there's not really a sermon. It's just me wanting to brag from you and tell you how great I think you are. Is that okay? All right? I want to continue on because I see people in this room today that just really inspire me. Some of you are brand new to our church, and some of you, I've been with this from the very beginning, and some of the things that you're walking through and some of the things that you're dealing with, it's really cool to see you get outside yourself and prepare a meal for somebody. Prepare a meal for people that are hurting. I don't know, but they were in the early service today, but Bob and Lori Gideon. Bob Gideon has lost both of his parents in the last 36 hours. And they both been sick. Hospice was called in at the beginning of the week. They knew it was coming down to an end of days for them. And both of them were elderly, and both of them had lived a full life. But it was very rare for both of them to go down quickly like they were. You hear about these random stories of people who've been married for 50, 60, 70 years, and they pass within a certain amount of time. I thought, man, what a cool thing. But his mother passed away on Friday afternoon, and his father passed away on Saturday morning, less than 12 hours apart. And they're members of our, Bob is a member of our church, and in a way that we can pray for them, we want to pray for them. Visitation's going to be tomorrow night. We'll have that email out to you tomorrow. The funeral's on Tuesday. Both of them, it's going to be a joint funeral. And I asked Bob yesterday, I said, is it easier or is it harder knowing that both of them left the way they did? And he said, you know, I'm just going to have to go to bed and wake up tomorrow and find out. You know, I don't know if it's better that both of them passed. Or if one of them, you know, we don't have to go through the whole thing again. We don't have to have multiple funerals. We don't have multiple time of dragging out a difficult, long illness. But he said, I woke up today and both of my parents were gone. And so he's dealing with that. He's struggling with that. Angela's going to be out in the foyer today. She's got a clipboard out there. If you'd like to prepare a meal for them, we want to try to help them, not just for them, but for the family, too, at the funeral, right? And she's going to talk to you more about that at the end of service today. And so we'll talk about that. But we need some people to help prepare for that and help love on that. And you do so good at that. When we're hungry, when we're thirsty, when we're sick, when we're imprisoned, how do we meet each other's needs? And you do that. And you do that very, very well. For those of you that are new to our church and you wonder, man, how can I get involved in something like that? I don't know these people. You don't have to know anybody to bake cookies for somebody in prison. You don't have to know me very well to bring me cookies at church. You can just do that, all right? And there doesn't even have to be a reason for it, all right? You can just show them. But there doesn't have to be, you don't have to know somebody to prepare a meal, to pray over the ingredients of that meal, to pray for, as you prepare that meal and put it together, who it's getting ready to go to. You never know how you're going to touch somebody. And you do that all the time. For those of you that are maybe guests for the first time here, or you've been visiting for a little bit, you're wondering, is this the kind of church that helps each other? Is this the kind of church that ministers to each other? Oh my goodness, let me just start pulling out names and faces in the crowd and say, look what they've done, look what they've done. I want to brag a little bit on some of our office staff. We've got some of the greatest staff that you could ever hope for. Amber DeVore and Marcia Fuque and Dave McBride are three of our office staff, and they've become very accustomed at how we do things and how the routine is in the office and things like that. But I want you to know they're not just typists, they're not just number crunchers, they're not just anything like that. I called somebody last night who's been sick, has been diagnosed with cancer, has had different ins and outs of the chemotherapy and the radiation they've been going through. It's just been wrecking them. And I called last night to check on them, and I was talking to them a little bit. It was her birthday. I didn't know it was her birthday. I hadn't checked on her recently, and I didn't know who the circumstances that were going through there. I was just kind of calling and checking. But you know what? Somebody knew it was her birthday. And it was your office assistant, membership assistant secretary, Amber DeVore, that knew it was her birthday. And she took a little something over there yesterday just to say, I love you. I noticed it was your birthday. Happy birthday. You know what? Amber has kids and ball games on Saturdays. Amber's been down in the back lately, been in and out of the chiropractor. She just got back from Gatlinburg and had a lot of things going on and doing stuff like that. She remembered it was Jamie's birthday. And she took her a little something just to say, I love you. That's office staff that says, I'm not just a typist, I'm not just a secretary, there's ministry going on. Do you realize at any given point I can walk in and there's somebody sitting in one of their offices or sitting at one of their desks and there's ministry going on? There's people that they talk to on the phone that I don't even know about. And they're talking to them and they're ministering them and they're meeting their needs. It's happening in your deacons, it's happening with your elders and pastors. And I'll brag at him a little bit, he's not in the room, but Pastor Billy, you know, what an asset he is to any church, to be able to just talk to random strangers and to be able to visit with them and talk to them on a level that I can't talk to them. because of how God saved him and what God saved him from and what God saved him out of, man, he knows right where people are that I don't. I haven't lived there. I've grown up in the church all my life, but Billy can just cut right through the stuff and sees them in a different way and can minister to them in a different way. And you can be proud of your staff and your pastors and the people that are serving you and coming alongside, because I'll tell you what, it is more often than not above and beyond the call of duty. It's easy to sit back and say, man, that's what we pay y'all for. But let me tell you, you don't pay us for near the stuff that goes on outside these walls and half the stuff that goes on. It's just, it doesn't. It is an amazing thing to watch over and over and over again. And I'm fed by that. I am fed by that. In the scriptures, we see people praying, Lord, fill me with your spirit. And we've taught on this before. Hey, once you're filled with the spirit, shouldn't you just always be full of the spirit? And you always have the spirit present in you, but there's a pouring out of the spirit, this hope, this light, this love that's changed you, that's transformed you. We pour that out. And guess what? That needs to be filled back up again. You'll see it two or three different times in the scripture where Peter was involved in a lot of different ministry and a lot of different activity. And guess what? It said then Peter filled with the Spirit, and the Spirit of God filled Peter. It says that he keeps doing it and doing it and doing it. And he does. The Spirit of God comes in and he gives you the power and the love and the mercy and the compassion to meet those needs as you go along. Because when you're pouring it out, you need to be filled back up. And that happened to me last night. I'm watching a ball game. I'm talking to Jane. She's been in and out of radiation. It's just killing her. And she had enough power in her voice to tell me and to brag on how Indiana beat Kentucky a few weeks ago. And I thought about hanging up on her. Because the good feeling kind of came and went. And she said, you won't believe that ever came over today. And I said, what? Tell me what's going on. And so she was telling me about that. She was very pleased. And so for you guys that do things behind the scenes and never get any credit for it, your reward will be great in heaven. Seek not the glory and the honor and the privilege and men's applause. It is so fleeting. It comes and it goes, and it might boost you for a season, but it will not last. Look forward to that reward that you'll receive. When the gates are open and the arms open, he says, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful with the little that I gave you. Enter into the joy of my rest. Don't you want to hear that? Let me ask you a question again. What kind of difference has Easter made in you? Not just March 27th, but what kind of difference is the transforming power of the resurrected Christ? The same power that did that now lives in you. Are you any different? How has the resurrection changed your sanctification? How has it developed you? How has it growing you? The spiritual gifts that you have, the natural abilities, and the things that you do, the things that you're just naturally good at. If you need some carpentry work done in your house, don't call me. If you need some stuff done in your car, some work done in your car, don't call me. I'm not good at that, and so I'm not going to volunteer it. You may have all kinds of problems in your home, but I'm not going to do it. If you have some electrical problems, don't call me. Call Gary Guy. He'll call the pole for you. He'll do it. He'll help you with it. If you need some carpentry work, call some people that know how to do stuff like that. Don't call me, because I'm not looking for those opportunities to serve you. If you need some help with your golf game, I'm the man. When it comes to that, I'm like, I can help you with that kind of thing. And would love to. What can you do? How's Easter changed you? What is the meaning of resurrection and new life and the excitement of knowing that I have a hope and I have a security and I have an understanding that what's been promised to me, I'm going to get it. How does that change you? How does that make you different? For us here at the church, we can ask you to do a lot of things. we can try to equip you, we can try to teach you, we can try to beg you, we can put stuff in the bulletin, we send it out in an email, we'll put it on the screen, we'll talk about it from here. What does it take to get you involved in each other and in ministry? I don't know, because we can put it in print all we want to. We can put it electronically out all we want to. I can talk about it till I'm blue in the face, but there's got to be a want to in you. There's got to be a desire in you that is only birthed from your new birth. It's not natural for us to just want to help other people. It's not natural for us to sacrifice something of ours to give to something and to someone else. It's not. To ask you for $5 when everybody else is asking you for $5. To ask you to make a meal when the cupboard's bare and you got to go to the grocery store and get it. To ask you to make some cookies and to get $5 for a meal for somebody in prison. You can easily say, man, they already make food for people in prison. But they don't make the kind of food that you make. It's different. It's different when you're in prison, when you're there and you're trapped. And all of a sudden you realize somebody outside the walls, it's not your mama or daddy, care enough to sacrifice for you. What kind of difference is the resurrection making in your sanctification, in your growth process? If you're not spiritually growing, you might find that you're spiritually dying. If you're not becoming more and more like Jesus, you may find yourself resisting Him more and more. In a few weeks, we're going to have a mission weekend in the middle of May, and it's not so much as a global mission as it is what we call Compel Outreach International. I have a friend of mine named Bill Britt. He is a former pastor of mine, a dear friend of mine, and he's going to be here. He's going to be here for a whole weekend. He's going to have an opportunity to share a men's breakfast on Saturday. He's going to preach both morning services on May the 15th, and then we're going to have a golf tournament. This is the golf tournament we've been talking about that we want you to be involved in. Bill Britt is the founder of Compel Outreach International. He's been a global evangelist, a gospel proclaimer for 30 years, and has been faithfully sharing the gospel all over the place. In the middle of going and preaching great crusades, they've also been able to be a part of establishing some new works around the world. There's orphanages in Kenya. There's Bible seminaries in India. And they call him Big Papa because he's a big papa, let me tell you. And so he's a big old guy, but he is all over the world. Don't you, this is what Bill Britt is right here. That right there. That's Big Papa. Big Papa loves kids. And because of what they've been able to do, the gospel they've been able to share, people coming to Christ all over the place, he's going into all these places, into these villages, into these other places, teaching people how to minister the gospel. We're a part of that. When we first started the church, we started giving monthly to Compel just straight out of our budget. And we start off with like $50, and then went to $100 a month, and I think we're giving like $250. How much are we? $200 a month to Compel, and you know what, we can continue to give straight out of our budget and never see pictures and never have Bill here, and you don't know anything about him, and part of us is going to go to them. But boy, when he comes here and he begins to share the gospel that he's sharing all over the place, and you hear him and you hear his heart and you hear his vision, you're going to want to be compelled to act. And I'm telling you, I don't want that just to be because he's special and he's coming in. God's doing something special to him, but he's just an ordinary guy. Well, he's a little bit extraordinary because he's a Cowboy fan. Dallas Cowboys, there you go. So he's a great guy, he's a great friend, he's a great preacher and a powerful proclaimer. He's all of these things, but man, he loves Jesus. When Jesus is in him, it can't help but come out of him. They're training in India, they're training pastors because they realize they can go and they can preach all they want to, but when they start training born-again pastors there to take the gospel into their villages, to know how to preach and teach, that's how it happens, y'all. You make a disciple, that disciple goes and makes a disciple. Those disciples go and they make other disciples. That's how it works. We teach, we equip, we come alongside. I have a love and a passion for the church that I've had all my life. I've known ever since I was a teenager that I'm going to serve in the church. I'm going to be a part of the church experience, and I'm going to help grow the church. And when we started, we said, part of our mission is to grow the saved so that you may reach the lost. That's my heartbeat. Brother Bill is to go forth into all the nations He's an evangelist. He's an outside-the-wall proclaimer. He's a teacher and equipper for everybody around the world. And I'm one of the guys that shepherds a local flock of people. We're different, but we couldn't be more the same in love with Jesus and how the church advances the gospel around the world. How has Easter changed you? For me, I started church with some friends. And the church grows and it grows and it grows. And my love for you grows and it grows and it grows. For Bill, he's tried to pastor a couple of times, but you can't take a lion out of the savannah of Africa and put him in a cage and say, enjoy your life. Here's a business meeting. Y'all go pick out the color of the carpet, what kind of toilet paper we're going to use in the women's restroom. You know, you got to set that brother free because he must be out there teaching and proclaiming the word. We're different. We're all different pieces to this puzzle. But how has Easter changed you, and what are you going to do about it? How's Easter changed me, and what am I doing about it? I'm very encouraged about where we are as a body, about where we are as a church. Our elders have been meeting recently, and the question keeps coming up, what's next? What's next? We had 601 people, or we had 601 in attendance last week at Easter. We average right about 380 to 400, you know, in and around that time. We've been hitting the 400 mark a lot, but there's a lot of duplicates in there, people that are serving and everything. We had 601 on Sunday. Now, there were some duplicates in that, people coming to multiple services and everything like that, but our best guess of it would be around 550, 570 people that were here. What an incredible number for us. But if all we do is we walk in the door, we pat ourselves on the back going, hey, we invited people to church. They came. We had 600 people. Man, we're a big church. No. We may have 380 or 402 today. I don't know. It's not about that number. It's about who we are individually, who we are as a body, who we are. We're going to ask you to play in a golf tournament so that kids around the world can have a meal. We're going to ask you to come to a men's breakfast and invite a friend to men's breakfast so somebody in India can be trained of how to preach and share the gospel. We're going to ask you to give some money to Brother Bill to help further his ministry on along because it's his lifeblood. That's the only thing he did. He didn't draw salary from anything. It's our giving. It's people like us to give. And we're going to do, we'll be talking more about that. You'll be seeing in your bulletins over what's coming up. We've got a table out there completely dedicated to that and how you can be involved. You realize that in a golf tournament, you may not play golf. You may not be a people person. You may not have a lot of money. But you can go spend $3-4 at the Dollar Tree and get some snacks and bring it and put it as a part of our mix at the golf tournament. People are going to snack. What does that have to do with the gospel? Nothing. But you know what it does? It brings the people that are coming to that golf tournament. It gets them more involved and more inclusive and more ready to be responsive to what Bill's going to share at the end of that golf tournament. There's lots of ways that you can be involved in ministry, but if your want to is not there, then all these things that we provide for you don't mean hell beings, does it? If you're changed, if your heart is tender, if you're ready to serve, if you're ready to act, you won't have to wait to be told what to do. You won't have to wait for anyone to say, hey, I need you over here. You're going to be asking. And you know what? I tell all of our people this that come for a membership interview because they're ready. They're chomping at the bit. They're ready. How can I serve? How can I get involved? How can I? What can I do? We don't have a lot of necessarily. We don't have committees and we don't have a lot of just ministry for ministry's sake. We're training you so that you can be aware of it wherever you are. Your ministry may not be in this church. Your ministry may be your next door neighbor. Your ministry may be in your home. Your ministry may be a part of a broken family. They're dealing with some really rough stuff. Bob Gini could tell you. You know, Annie just came back from Puerto Rico. She's been, her mother 2 weeks ago had a massive stroke. And Annie rushed down there and was with the family. And what a rough 2 weeks it was. In and out of a dirty hospital and just a lack of care that was going on around the professional staff there. Some family issues and things like that that were going on. Being in Puerto Rico and on Easter Sunday when she wanted to be here, it was rough. And she comes back and 2 days after she gets back to the States, her mom passed away yesterday. And what can you do for Annie? Annie's a giant. She's awesome. Does that mean Annie can do it on her own? Not a chance. Your hug today will mean a lot. You may want to walk up to her. She's been at work for 2 weeks. You may want to walk up to her today and give her a $20 handshake. Just tell her that you love her. Know you've been out of work, I want to help you. You may not have $20 in your pocket. You know what? How can you help? Deacons, brothers, men. Ask her. Is her car need service? Is her yard you're looking after? Are you thinking of a home that needs repaired? How can you help? How can you be a part? You may not have anybody verses memorized. You may be new to the church and not know anybody. And you can come up to me at the door and say, who's this Annie? I'd like to go help her. I'll tell you who she is. You won't miss her for very long. How can you be a help? How can you serve? Because I see it all over the place. I see it in you. I see it in others. I see people that are coming and going. And I'm proud of them, church. You're doing great work. What's next? What's next? How can you continue on? I'd be remiss today if I had a group this size and we didn't get to open the scriptures together. Take your Bible out, if you would. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And we'll close with this. It's been a different Sunday and a different time here. And I don't apologize for that. I was asking the Lord this week, Lord, I'm not ready to jump right into chapter 2 yet. I'm not quite sure. I've got some things that I want to tell them. I've got some things I want to share with them, some things I want to brag on them for. And so I do believe that the Lord put it in my heart to encourage you today. So let the scripture encourage you. If you would stand with me, even sit for a little while, some of you are getting sleepy. We're almost done. This is not the beginning. That wasn't the intro. Some of you are thinking, holy cow, he's just starting to preach. No. Chapter 4, verse 1 in Ephesians says this. Paul talks, he says, I'm a prisoner of the Lord. I implore you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling with which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love, being diligent to preserve the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Now, let's stop right there for just a second. I'm not going to do that for all the verses, but just this part right here, walk in a manner worthy of your calling. Do you realize that when you were born again, that you were given, that you were set on a journey toward Christ and with Christ to grow in His likeness, to be like Him? So when the scripture talks about walking, it's talking about your life, your behavior, your activity, where you are in life. Walk in a manner worthy of your calling is to say, walk like Christ. You remember the old song, walk like an Egyptian. You remember that? You're going to walk like Christ. You're going to look like Christ. How you do that is in verse 2 and 3. This is different from what the world sees because we're going to walk this way with all humility and gentleness, with patience, showing tolerance for one another in love. The world is screaming for tolerance, isn't it? The world is tired of hearing the church preach at it. The world is tired. What is it calling us? We're intolerant, bigoted, hypocrites. That's what we are. That's the reputation the church has in the world because we don't agree with them. We're intolerant. Because we don't agree with their lifestyle, we're bigoted. Because we don't agree with certain things that the world chooses to claim as truth, we're now something less than. But I think it's because a lot of the times our walk has not been in a manner worthy of your calling. It's not been a walk in Christ because there's an absence of humility and gentleness and patience. You think because someone is a homosexual that you can point the finger in their face and say, you're wrong and you're going to hell. There's no humility, there's no gentleness, and there's no patience. Continue to love them. Continue to share the gospel with them. Continue to have conversations with them. You don't have to flee from every sinner that's out there. Why? You'd be running circles the whole time because you're a sinner yourself. All right? You've got your own problems and your own sins. Oh, you like to kind of slough them off to the side a little bit there, you know, because you don't want anybody to see that stuff. But walk in a manner of your calling is walking worthy of Christ. Okay? It says in verse 4, there's one body, one spirit, just as you also were called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. Verse 7, to each one of us grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Grace was given to you, believers, to you that have chosen to surrender your lives to God. Grace was given to you, a measure of grace and gifts have been given to you. Look at verse 11, here's some gifts. Some were given as apostles, some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers. That's right, I'm your gift. You can thank God for that today. But what's my job? It spells it out in Scripture, because you're thinking, man, what in the world are we paying you for? This is it in verse 12. What am I supposed to do for you? Equip. This is why the pastors are here. This is why when we walk in a manner worthy of our calling, we're walking worthy in Christ. Our job is to equip the saints for what? For the work of service or for ministry, to the building up of the body of Christ. It's you. It's not just me. It's not a dynamic preaching ministry or a worship ministry or a serving ministry or small groups or anything else. It's you. It's the gospel being in you and changing you, and the resurrected Christ now resurrecting you and making you walk in new life. That should change you. The power of his love. And you do the work of service and build up the body of Christ. How long do we have to do that? It says in verse 13. Somebody tell me. How long? Until we all attain to the unity of faith, right? So if you're stopping short, we're not there yet. If there are 400 people here today and 395 of us are walking in a manner worthy of our calling and five are left behind, we're not there yet. We teach you. We equip you, we love you, and we encourage you, but we do it together until we all attain to the unity of faith. What's the point? Well, I missed my page. And the point is this in verse 13, until we all attain to the unity of faith, of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of a stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. As a result, we are no longer to be children, tossed here and there by waves, and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men, by craftiness and deceitful scheming, but speaking the truth in what? We are to grow up. We are to grow up in all aspects to under him who is the head, even Christ. For the body builds itself up in love, is the conclusion of verse 16. Guys, you're special. You're part of a special work. There's not any other church like us. There are things that we do that are similar, but there's not any other church that's like us. How are we going to be unique? How are you going to be unique? How has Easter changed you? Will you let it? Will you be different? Do people notice? Hope they will. Trust that they will. When we leave today, I pray for a bond of unity. Pray for a bond of togetherness, that the pep rally is about over. You're about to step foot in between the sidelines, and now it's game time. You know what to do? You know how to help each other? That offensive lineman decides, I'm not getting enough glory, and I don't want to block. How good is that quarterback? He's dead. And we're together. We're doing what we're supposed to be doing. Oh, it's good. It's so good. And you're doing great. But what can we do better? Okay? Next week, we'll continue on our series in 1 Peter chapter 2. And we'll talk to you about what living stones are. It sounds like a contradictory. I know the stone can't come to life. I want to explain to you how this takes flesh next week and how we can do that better. Okay? I'm going to ask you to be seated for a quick second. And we have some things that we want to close with. But Marshall, would you find the third verse of that hymn again, coming up now? You did so good singing that while ago. I want to hear it some more. Actually, find the second verse. Find the second verse. This is all of our testimonies today. Ready?
I was lost in utter darkness till you came and rescued me. I was down by all my sin when your love came and set me free.
Now here's the difference.
Now my soul can sing a new song. Now my heart has found a home. Now your grace is always with me, and I'll never be alone.
You can take that to the bank. Amen. Amen. We got a couple of closing announcements, and the day when they're finished, you come and close us in prayer, my brother. All right. Come on, farmer girl. Come tell us what this is all about.
There she is.
If we're not plugged in, Lord, Chris has challenged us to please find whatever it is that we would want to do, but make sure that it is in alignment with what you would have us to do. Just be with each of us when we leave here today. We thank you for the wonderful service that we had last week, where we get to commemorate your birth your death, your resurrection, and the fact that you're sitting there waiting for each of us to allow you to come into our hearts. Father, thank you for each of us. Lead, guide, direct us when we leave here today. And all God's people say, amen. Amen.